Thank you very much. Good evening. My name is Mukesh Aghi, and I'd like to welcome our Vice President of the United States, Joe Biden, to USIBC Annual Leadership Summit. Before I go to my prepared introduction, I was talking to him because first time I met him almost 15 years ago in Davos, and he was the senator, and he said, Mukesh, you got to do something for India. It's a great country. It's going in the right direction. You got to make some things happen there. And so, Mr. Vice President, I've come over now to USIBC with your support to make great things happen for India itself. We could have asked for a more fitting leader to address the Council's 40th anniversary. As many of us who have been part of the US-India partnership would know, Vice President Biden has been a longstanding friend of India. He has reiterated on many occasions Washington's commitment to taking the US-India partnership to a newer height, and has specifically laid out the ambitious goal of achieving $500 billion bilateral trade between India and the United States. Vice President Biden was an instrumental figure in framing the landmark US-India Civil Nuclear 123 Agreement. The Vice President continues to play an active role in supporting the administrative rebalance to the Asia-Pacific region. As India and the United States deepen their collaboration, we look forward to hearing Vice President Biden's thought on the future and the promise of partnership between the world's oldest and largest democracy. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together once again for Vice President of the United States, Joe Biden.
Thank you, Doc. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Doctor. That's a very nice introduction, and it's a delight to be here with you all. You're going to hear from a number of people during this dialogue, and two of our best, Secretary Kerry and our Secretary of Commerce. Happy 40th anniversary. This is a very important group. And we have with us our ambassador, joined by the Indian Foreign Minister, the Minister of State and Commerce, the Indian Minister of State for Power and Energy. I was telling him, what a great title, Minister of Power. So many cabinet members seek that. But it's great to see so many distinguished leaders of business, government, civil society in both our countries join together here tonight. This, in my view, is a propitious moment for the U.S.-India relationship. We're in a new era as we kick off the first strategic and commercial dialogue between our two countries. The President and I and the entire administration believe that the India-U.S. bilateral relationship will be a relationship that will go a long way in defining the 21st century. And that is not hyperbole. I was saying to the doctor that I've been hanging around a long time. John, not quite as long, but actually it's almost exactly the time. But we remember those chilly days of the Cold War and the extent of the non-aligned movement. But what we're doing today is we're starting to work together in a fundamentally different way than we have in the past. The Irish poet Yeats said, talking about his Ireland in 1916, there was a line in his poem, he said, all's changed, changed utterly. Well, all has changed in the relationship between India and the United States, and what impediments existed or were perceived to exist in the past no longer exist, in my view. There's no reason in the world why the two largest democracies shouldn't continue to have an increasingly better and more productive relationship. As John will remember, I was chairman of the committee when we did the civil nuclear deal a decade ago, and it was a breakthrough. It was important in and of itself, But what it did more than that, it basically said there's a new relationship. Business as usual is not how we're going to continue to proceed. As chairman of the committee at the time, we led the effort to ratify that historic agreement. And both John and I knew it was the absolutely right thing to do for both our countries. But as I said, it went beyond the four corners of the document. It said there's a new relationship, a new sense of trust. It was a vote for India and the future in the partnership between our two countries. It required us to challenge entrenched orthodoxies and set aside decades of estrangement to achieve something that was long overdue by the time we did it. And we've made great progress. You've made great progress since then. Today, not only is there a convergence of common interest between our nations, there's also an unprecedented commitment among our leaders to seize this unique moment. The President and I think John would agree, one of our most constructive meetings ever with a foreign leader was the one where the President hosted Prime Minister Modi at the White House last year. I've been doing this a long time. It was truly, truly a recognition of a change, a continuing movement toward this change in the relationship for the better. We talked about everything from the economy to climate to regional security. Secretary Kerry and I spoke further about those issues when we hosted a lunch for Prime Minister Modi at the State Department. And when the President attended India's Republic Day, he declared that the United States and India are not just natural partners, but that America can be India's best friend. It's no longer about what we can do for India. It's about what we can do with India. It's about what we can do together. That's our goal. Our goal of this administration, I think John would reaffirm it, is to become India's best friend. Best friend. To continue the dialogue on strategic relationship as well as the commercial relationship. On strategy, which Secretary Kerry will speak more about, meeting the greatest challenges of this century, economic, environment, public health, international security. It requires our two nations working together as strategic partners to bring about a safer and a more prosperous world. And it's interesting, think about this. The convergence of India's Act East and the United States' rebalancing to Asia is good news not only for the region, but for the entire world. If I had made this speech to you 25 years ago and said that was going to be the case, I doubt whether many people would have thought that was likely to happen. It's a conversion of interest from the Pacific Ocean to the Indian Ocean to the eastern shores of Africa that expands our defense security relationship, greater joint military exercises, greater exchange of defense technology, joint efforts to maintain freedom of navigation. No time in the history of the world is freedom of navigation more important. Right now, 90% of all the world's economy is sitting on the back of a ship somewhere floating in the ocean. Freedom of navigation in this global economy is even more important than it has been in any other time in world history. And greater humanitarian assistance and disaster relief. And to see them through, we need to stand together on counterterrorism and countering violent extremism. And for the relationship to reach its potential, we have to solve the world's top problems together. And the definitional issue of our time is climate change. I need not tell you what happens in India and in the Indian Ocean if, in fact, sea rises another foot or a foot and a half. Our Defense Department several years ago decided that global warming presented a national security issue of great consequences. You see migrations in Europe right now out of the Middle East. Imagine sea levels continue to rise in 10, 20, 30, 40 years, the displacement of millions of people. On the commercial track, which Secretary Pritzker will help lead, there's so much potential for trade and investment. There's no reason why we can't multiply, as the doctor pointed out, our overall trade and exports to India and our investments in India by a factor of five or more over the next decade. But we need to see more reforms, quite frankly. As I said to President Modi, Prime Minister Modi, and his predecessor, we never presume to tell another nation what's in their interest. That's for them to decide. We can only look at what we believe is in our interest, and hopefully the Indian political leadership sees it in their interest as well. And there's enormous potential. But the rules of the road have to be universally followed. We need to see more reforms to protect intellectual property. As I've said on other occasions, talking to many of you in this room, you know, everybody wonders why here in the United States we have been able to make such enormous progress in science and technology when other nations are graduating as many and more scientists and more engineers and more physicists. It's because you can't innovate where you can't breathe free air, and you can't generate an indigenous innovative population without rewarding and protecting their intellectual property. We have to ease limits on foreign investment and make it easier for businesses to sell their products and services in the marketplace. More bilateral trade, in my humble opinion, is for India to decide, is in the overwhelming interest of both our countries. And that can only occur if we continue to liberalize trade with shared rules of the road. There's going to be some hard discussions here. This is difficult work. There are many entrenched interests in both our countries for whom the status quo is just fine. The status quo is just fine. But all leaders have to look at what we use the trite expression, the big picture, the bigger picture. We applaud and we will do everything we can to support Prime Minister Modi's ambitious economic reforms and his understanding that no nation should have to choose between prosperity and sovereignty. That is a false choice in 2015. And what I think everyone in this room understands is that ultimately, commercial success depends on the development of human capital. It's India's greatest resource. And my Lord, have we benefited from that Indian greatest resource here in the United States of America. We've experienced it firsthand. 3 million Indian Americans whose talents have shaped the fabric of this country. In our schools, our hospitals, our research labs, in our courtrooms, in our government, in the arts and entertainment, and from Silicon Valley to Main Street, it reflects that incredible talent. Reflected also in the uniforms so many Indian Americans wear for the United States military. As Prime Minister Modi will see during his visit to California this week, entrepreneurship is hardwired in our DNA as it is in yours. Entrepreneurs of Indian origin founded 15% of the Silicon Valley startups. Half a dozen of the Fortune 500 companies are led by Indian Americans, some of whom are here today, tonight. 100,000 Indian students study at American universities. And we aim to double that by the year 2020 and triple the number of American students studying in India. But as we see in America, reaching our full potential requires empowering everyone. And we haven't always been quick to do that. Empowering immigrants, empowering everyone of their, regardless of their ethnic or religious minority status, and those in the LGBT community, and especially women. And both our nations have to resist the forces of intolerance and remain vigilant in our efforts to make our democracy stronger and more inclusive. It's not just the morally right thing to do, it's the economic necessary thing to do. We're both major players on the world stage. And it's up to us, India and the United States, to lead not by the example of our power, but by the power of our example. As I said, it's not just the morally right thing to do. It's in the long-term economic interest of India and, quite frankly, the whole world. And it works. Let me state the obvious for you, give you an example. In the United States, over the second half of the 20th century, the share of women in the workforce doubled almost, adding millions of talented and valuable workers to the U.S. economy. Women were the engine that drove the rise of this economic superpower, led by a thriving middle class. It can be the same for all nations. If you excuse an American speaking in an audience quoting the Chinese, there's a Chinese expression, and I'm sure there's one that's better in India. It says, women hold up half the world. Women hold up half the world. One of the dearest friends of the Biden family is Kathy Russell, our ambassador at large for global women's issues. Kathy joined Jill and me on our trip to India a few years ago. We got to meet with your then prime minister and your leaders in Delhi and also spent some time in Mumbai. And I apologize for repeating this, but when I was in Mumbai, it was with the Chamber of Commerce, and you know it's a thriving commerce, it's a thriving chamber. And we held a large meeting the next day. We followed up in a press conference. And I had said at the first meeting, I said, you know, years ago when I was elected to the Senate as a 29-year-old kid, I received a letter from a man named Biden who lived in Mumbai. And he said, I think we're related. And he went back and wasn't only think, he went back to our mutual great-great-great-grandfather, 1848. Who was a British captain in the East Indian Tea Company. And he married, I believe, an Indian woman, and he settled in India. So the next day, the press, I guess, trying to prove that I was probably making this up, because I never followed up. It was right after I got elected, and then some things happened in my family, and I never followed up. One reporter stood up and gave me the names of five Bidens in Mumbai. So show me more respect. You know what I mean? I didn't realize I had so many. And I haven't actually followed up and embarrassed the Bidens in Mumbai. But the point is, it makes it even clearer what a small world this is, and how this global economy is suited for, quite frankly, the two largest democracies in the world. When we were there, we visited a small village where we saw firsthand the transformative power of literacy and basic education, unlocking the potential of women and girls in this rural village. Then we went on to the Indian Institute of Technology. I hope you don't mind the comparison. It's the MIT of your country. It's one of the great institutions in the world. And I sat for the better part of, I guess, an hour and a half with a group of half a dozen to a dozen young women. They were young women who were all students there. They were incredible. And they were not only studying to become the best engineers, computer scientists, and future leaders, they knew what they were doing. They believed that all they needed was to be empowered. And they could make, and they talked about the great contributions they hoped to make to Indian society. It was uplifting. It was inspiring. And it was an impressive display of the power of young women and their potential to transform Indian society. Both of us, the United States and India, in my view, the whole world has to continue to unlock the potential of more than half the population in the world. And this strategic and commercial dialogue is a place to talk about it. What it all comes down to is the sense of possibilities. I'm going to be greeting President Xi as he lands the end of this week. And I spent a lot of time with him because when he was vice president, he and I spent 5 days traveling together in China and 3 here because because President Hu and President Obama thought we should get to know one another. And at a dinner that he recalls, he and I were alone with just one staff person, an interpreter. And he asked me, how would I define America? And I said, Mr. Vice President, I can do that in one word. Possibilities. 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 And there are so many possibilities for India. We're truly on the precipice of something transformational. Secretary Kerry has heard me quote Irish poets too many times. But as I already quoted Yeats, he greatly admired, I hope I pronounced it correctly, Tagore, the famous Indian poet. And Yeats wrote a foreword to Tagore's book of poetry that won the Nobel Prize at the turn of the 20th century. And this is what he wrote. He said, his lyrics are full of subtle rhyme, of untranslatable delicacy, of invention, the work of supreme culture. Look at India today, in the 21st century, humming, dynamic, engaged, full of possibilities. A great and ancient society reinventing itself, just as we are reinventing the most defining of relationships. Tagore also wrote, quote, you can't cross the sea merely by standing and staring at the water. Well, in my view, excuse my inclination to Irish rhetoric, the truth of the matter is, what you all are doing together is crossing the sea together. We're standing at the precipice of an incredible opportunity. That's what this first dialogue is all about. And I'm grateful to all of you for leading it, because I honest to goodness believe that the potential is unlimited if we just understand how great it is. Thank you all for inviting me to speak, and I wish you a great, great, great conference. Thank you.
Vice President Biden, thank you for your kind words. And on that note, I also would like to give a special recognition and invitation to Honorable Secretary Kerry, Honorable Commerce Secretary Penny Pritzker, Honorable Minister of External Affairs Sushma Swaraj, Honorable Minister of State for Power, Coal and Renewable Energy Piyush Goyal, Honorable Minister of State for Commerce Nirmala Sitharaman, United States Trade Representative Mike Froman, and we do have Congressman Ami Bera among us. I also would like to invite Ambassador Arun Singh and Richard Verma, the U.S. Ambassador to India itself. We do have a lot of other dignitaries in the room, so I have missed. Please, I apologize for that. But I think it's important that we bring in our next speaker to the podium itself. We do have Secretary Kerry, who has been a big, big supporter of India. He has been coming to India multiple times. In fact, in January, he was in Gujarat at the Vibrant Gujarat Summit earlier, and he spoke about how we can focus USIBC on trying to bring in SMEs into India itself. So I'm pleased to say, Mr. Secretary, that on your challenge, we are able to announce today the U.S. Business Center is open in India now, supporting SMEs itself. So, ladies and gentlemen, Secretary of State John Kerry of the United States.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Agi. I'm very appreciative. Thank you all. Thank you for a standing ovation. I want you to know that Winston Churchill, who had no small part in some of your lives very long time ago, once said that the only reason that people give a standing ovation is that they desperately need an excuse to shift their underwear. So I have learned to take it with a real grain of salt. I've been in public life for more than three, four decades now, and as Joe Biden knows, following anybody is always hard. Following Joe Biden is particularly hard. I'm blessed to have a terrific friend as well as a great colleague. I am not going to quote an Irish poet, and I do not have a Kerry in India that I know of. But I hope you will all nevertheless embrace the passion that I have always shared for the relationship between the United States and India. And in fact, my connection goes back way back in time when I was a young senator, and I brought the first trade delegation of Americans to India right at the time that later to be Prime Minister Singh was serving as finance minister and the reforms were just setting in. So I share the Vice President's deep commitment to India, and I was pleased to work with him when he was chairman of the committee to help pass the nuclear agreement. It's a pleasure for me to be joined here this evening by my colleague, Penny Pritzker, and also by my friend, Minister Sushma Swaraj. Sushma says that she and I represent the long and the short of diplomacy. And you'll understand that if you don't know her well later. And I also pleased to welcome Minister Nirmala, Sitharaman. Thank you for being here with us. And we have many other distinguished guests here. I just want to single out Nisha Biswal, our very capable, outstanding Assistant Secretary of State for South and Central Asian Affairs. And I want to recognize our terrific ambassador, who I worked with many years up on the Hill, of Rich Verma, and also the ambassador from India to the United States, Arun Singh. We are really delighted to have you here. Thank you for coming. It's a 40th anniversary, and increasingly, as the years go by, 40 seems pretty damn young to me. But it's a great pleasure to recognize the extraordinary work of the U.S.-India Business Council and all of you here, and to many of our very, very capable, beyond capable, globally recognized, extraordinary CEOs who are here of major companies, and so many of you who are forging this relationship, we thank you. I have learned long ago that when you are a speaker, and there are several other speakers to come, and there are, because each of my colleagues is going to have a chance to quickly say hello to you, and we are all that stands between you and a meal, I'm not going to give you a long policy speech. The Vice President talked about our policy eloquently, and as he noted, I'll just say to you quickly that the excitement that was reflected last January on Republic Day, when President Obama became the first American to be welcomed as the chief guest, was really extraordinary. And there were times when such an honor for a U.S. official would have been simply unfathomable. But we have entered a new era, as the Vice President said, marked by a rapidly developing network of commercial ties, a deep well of affection that is growing between our two peoples, and a genuine warmth at the highest level. I was at the dinner in the White House, the Vice President referred to, with Prime Minister Modi, and it was really interesting to watch these two men connect as they talked in quite technical terms and in quite in-depth, detailed terms about the profound technology and transformational opportunities that lie before us. It was fun to watch, I will tell you. And needless to say, you know the world has changed when Diwali is brought into the White House and the President and First Lady dance with children in Mumbai. Something obviously is happening. Now, I personally felt that when I was at the Vibrant Gujarat meeting, the summit, earlier this year. And while there's always room for improvement, it's very, very clear that the climate for bilateral investment and trade has never been better. And that is true in everything, from clean energy to aerospace to financial services and movies, where obviously Hollywood and Bollywood reign supreme. It's a great time for innovators, and you heard the Vice President talk about the stunning statistics regarding Indian contribution to American innovation, let alone Indian innovation, and to what is happening today. But the only thing I want to spend a moment on, if I can, and I want to reinforce what the Vice President said on a topic that I've spent 25 years being involved in, and that is this great challenge of climate change. I want to express support for Prime Minister Modi's plan to help India's economy become more reliant on renewable sources of power. And it is absolutely critical in the end on pure economic terms. But it's also smart politically because a recent survey reported that 73% of Indians view climate change as the most pressing global concern. And as you know, I went to China 2 years ago. We negotiated an agreement, which ultimately the President and President Xi were able to announce last year in Beijing, where China came to the table, a developing country that was opposed to what we were working on in Copenhagen, but had come around to understand it was vital to respond on this issue. And they joined us in helping to set goals that we will go to Paris with this December in an effort to reach a global agreement. Now, for practical business people, let me just say to you, you know, I come from Massachusetts. I had the privilege of representing MIT and Harvard and Boston University and plenty of, about 140 other colleges and universities where there's an enormous innovative culture, as all of you know. The fact is that in that state, we are way ahead of a number of other places with respect to the understanding of this connection, because in the 1990s, the great wealth that was created in the United States of America, much of it came from there and then again from Silicon Valley, because it was the technology revolution of personal computers, of personal technology devices and communications that created the greatest wealth created in the United States since the 1920s, when we had no income tax. And during that period of time, we were exploiting a $1 trillion market that had 1 billion users. The energy market of today that is staring us in the face, waiting for people to grab onto, is a $6 trillion market with 4 to 5 billion users today, and it will rise to about 9 billion, if the statistics are correct, over the next 30 to 40 years. This is the mother of all markets. And it is the most extraordinary opportunity to do something that people in public life rarely get the opportunity to do. And that is to get a, you know, it's one thing when you make a public policy decision. Jane Harman is here. She'll tell you. If you can get one really good plus up out of that decision, you can go sell it to your constituents. This is something where, for the decision to move towards clean energy, you get numerous plus-ups. You live up to your obligation to future generations to do what we need to do with respect to the environment. We live up to our responsibilities with respect to children who are hospitalized. Greatest cause of hospitalization of children in the United States of America in the summer is environmentally induced asthma. It comes from the quality of air. We clean up the air. People are healthier, less cancer, less particulates in the air. But you also get the benefit of something called jobs. Millions of jobs waiting to be created in the process of the transition, which is transformative, to alternative, renewable, or other sources of energy as we decarbonize over a period of time. And it will take a period of time for those countries that are dependent on oil production and gas production. It's not going to happen overnight. And you also gain security. There's a nation in the world, look at Europe, dependent on one source for gas, held hostage. Does that have an effect on Ukraine? You bet your boots it does. So the possibilities of all of these plus-ups of jobs, your economy, of growth, of making the world more secure, of moving to a new economy, of having independence with respect to energy. It's rare you get an opportunity to sell people that, but it's also very rare that you have to sell it in the context of a 500-year drought, 500-year floods, extraordinary fires demolishing massive areas of wood and communities, insurance rates going up, insurance payouts going up. If people really factored in the true accounting of global climate change costs, you'd have a very different balance sheet than the one that people operate with today. So I just close by saying to everybody here, the strategic and commercial dialogue that we are entering into tomorrow is one of the most important that we have with any country on the planet. We are the largest and oldest democracies. We are the countries of innovation and opportunity. We think alike. We believe in human rights and opportunity for people. We have incredible diversity in our countries and tolerance. We have an ability to be able to build this future. And I believe that, you know, each of our countries this is really an historic mark and moment, because each of our countries came from the same colonial background. Each of our countries is ethnically and culturally diverse. And each is a laborer for peace, and each seeks a world in which the light of the human spirit overcomes darkness. And although differences of ideology have separated us in the past, and the Vice President referred to that a little bit, we are in the end, and I think that's what brings you here, the most natural of partners. So I hope that we will make the most of the opportunity that is staring us in the face, and I hope that India will be the partner with the United States that helps to get the job done for hundreds of millions, billions of people around this planet who are waiting for people to lead in the right direction and to make government live up to its fundamental responsibilities. Thank you all very, very much.
Thank you, Secretary Kerry. I am delighted and honored to invite Minister of External Affairs of India, Sushma Swaraj, for a keynote. Sushma Swaraj, as a minister and as a politician, has been a great friend of USIBC. In fact, this is her second time addressing the annual meeting itself.
Friends, this is the difficulty when I share the dais with the Foreign Minister, Secretary Kerry. we are tall and short of foreign ministers. I always address him as my tall friend. Therefore, today also, I would say, my tall friend, Honorable John Kerry, my dear friend, Honorable Madam Pritzker, my colleagues from India, Minister Nirmala Sitharaman, Minister Piyush Goyal, Mr. Mukesh Agi, President of the US IBC, friends from the business and government, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you very much, Secretary Kerry, for your warm and generous words. Let me also thank USIBC for inviting me and my ministerial colleagues from India to share the joy and success of USIBC at its 40th anniversary celebrations. I would also like to thank Vice President, His Excellency Joe Biden, for his gracious presence here and his resounding optimism about the India-US relations. This has created the right atmosphere for the first meeting of the India-US Strategic and Commercial Dialogue, which I look forward to co-chairing with my friend Secretary Kerry tomorrow. Friends, I also deeply appreciate the crucial role of my colleagues, Minister Sitharaman, Minister Piyush Goyal, and US Commerce Secretary Pritzker and Energy Secretary Muniz in the successful outcome of this dialogue. It is true that an important pillar in the broad sweep of our multifaceted partnership has been the strength and vigor of the private sector partnership between our two great democracies. USIBC and its membership manifest the tangibilities of this vitality in our economic and commercial ties. We have been one of the key drivers and a positive voice in the growth, evolution, and continuing maturing of India-US relations. I commend your achievements, and in keeping with our past successes, urge you to create new synergies that bring the businesses and governments closer to each other. Friends, today our relations with the United States are defined by a natural synergy of democracies and easy identification among our peoples. We are both open societies, which value education and enterprise. Institutions in both India and the United States, the executive, legislature, political parties, and businesses pulsate with the same values and beliefs. Americans of Indian origin epitomize the appreciation of excellence, reflecting the freedom and opportunity cherished in our countries. During the last 1.5 years of Prime Minister Modi's government, a sense of vigor and purpose, steady stream of new ideas, creative approaches, and focused action have dominated our bilateral engagement. Today, across both governments, there is a great deal of comfort, maturity, and candor in our conversation. There is political support for building relations with each other in both capitals, here in the US Congress and in our parliament. In last 1 year, we have worked to underpin our political and strategic convergences with concrete action on the ground to progress our overall engagement. We have harnessed the commonalities between our two countries to further bilateral priorities in several areas, including defense and security, countering terrorism and extremism, clean energy and environmental protection, science and technology and space, manufacturing and digital technology. We have developed mechanisms for co-development, co-production of defense equipment and practical collaboration in defense technologies to enhance the strategic content in our relations. Our countries are promoting energy cooperation to facilitate India's green growth, sustainable development, and energy security. We are doing so not only in the bilateral space, but also in responding to the global challenge of climate change. We are linked by ties of research, education, health and science, above all, in charting future path of cooperation in these areas. Our collaboration has not only served our two countries, but serve the wider world. Friends, one of the key priorities of Prime Minister Modi's government is to focus sharply on meeting India's developmental priorities and overcoming various challenges. Naturally, high economic growth is one of the ways for us to address our needs. But beyond relying on the downstream impact of high growth, the metrics of our responses also includes efficient, effective, and transparent policy and executive action. The approach of our government also envisages proactive and executive use of innovation, technology, and research to leapfrog sometime of the physical infrastructural constraints that we have. Friends, you are best placed to make your business decisions. But it would help if I underline here the scale of India's economic ambition and the size of economic opportunity that it represents for both our countries. Our focus is on building 100 smart cities, rejuvenating the Ganges River, and developing cities along its banks and skilling 300 million youth by 2022. We have plans to boost urbanization, and we are determined to provide affordable housing and power for all. We want to connect manufacturing in India with global supply chains and target to develop product-based and service-based industrial and governance platforms around digital India. All of these initiatives and plans present real commercial and business opportunities for the U.S. industry to partner with Indian public and private sector and with our larger economy for a win-win outcome. In doing so, and as is your key goal, you would of course create wealth for your organization. But equally importantly, you would add value to the society, build long-term links with India's economic growth story, and strengthen economic underpinnings of the India-US strategic partnership. The business of diplomacy in India, present government, is business. The government's priority from day one has been to make it easy to do business in India and with India. We want to ensure that the concerns of those who create jobs and bring value to our countries are addressed. The decisions taken by government have led to a significant jump in FDI flow into India in the last 1 year. Friends, as I said earlier, there is a strong recognition between our two governments of the largest strategic vision driving our partnership. That is why we elevated our relations through a declaration of friendship and adopted a joint strategic vision for Asia-Pacific and the Indian Ocean region earlier this year when our leaders met in New Delhi for India's Republic Day. This strategic vision is also what I would appeal our business friends in the U.S. to imbibe while doing business with India. We see business between our two countries not simply as transactions, but as yet another manifestation and another multiplier of that very important strategic convergence. We hope this will be reciprocated by the businesses. It will be a rewarding experience in more than one sense. I assure you that Government of India and my ministry in particular will be with you in every step of this endeavor. I end my remarks with full hope and confidence in my heart in the ability of our businesses to make the right choice for them and for our nations and for our 1.5 billion peoples, and to carry forward that choice through Sanjha Prayas Sabka Vikas, that is, shared effort, prosperity for all. Our joint effort would help make India-US partnership, as President Obama had said, unquote, one of the defining partnerships of the 21st century, unquote. Thank you very much. Jai Hind and Jai Indo-US friendship. Long live Indo-US friendship. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister, for the word of wisdom. I think at USIBC we stand to support the, some of the initiatives from Make in India to Digital India, supporting the Government of India policy, and also working together with the counterparts in the U.S. itself. On that note, I would like to invite Secretary of Commerce, Penny Pritzker. Madam Secretary has been a great, great supporter and has our offices open as we try to build the partnership between India and the U.S. On that note, Madam Secretary.
Thank you for that very warm welcome. And I want to thank the Vice President for joining us this evening. He has been a tremendous mentor to me during my time as Secretary of Commerce, especially when it comes to the international portion of my portfolio. I'm enormously grateful to him for his guidance and his friendship. It's also an honor to share the stage with my three co-chairs of the Strategic and Commercial Dialogue, Secretary Kerry, who's also been a longtime friend and mentor, Minister Swaraj, and Minister Sitharaman. Finally, I want to thank all of you at the U.S.-India Business Council for hosting us this evening. The Council and its membership play an invaluable role in advancing the U.S.-India economic partnership. So thank you for your very, very important work. President Obama and Prime Minister Modi share a vision for a stronger and more comprehensive U.S.-India relationship. Deeper trade and investment ties between our countries, the world's oldest and largest democracies, are an essential element of that vision. They have called on us to increase bilateral trade fivefold. The President and Prime Minister know that this is an ambitious goal, and it requires heightened engagement from our governments and the Indian and American private sectors, all of you here today. The good news is business between the United States and India has never been better. Our two-way trade nearly tripled in the last decade. American investments in India have more than tripled since 2004, and India is the fifth fastest growing source of foreign direct investment in the United States. This is tremendous growth in our bilateral commerce, which has created prosperity for businesses, our workers, and our communities in both of our nations. And with the initial steps taken by Prime Minister Modi to strengthen India's business climate, our commercial partnership should only grow in the years to come. Since his election, the Modi government has streamlined bureaucratic decision-making processes, raised foreign direct investment limits in insurance and defense and railway infrastructure. It's established commercial courts that can speed up the resolution of business disputes. And it's encouraged a race to the top between its states, asking its states to step up by ranking them in a very open and transparent fashion, which my colleague, Minister Sitharaman, has overseen, to show where those different states are friendly to business and where they have challenges. We commend the Prime Minister and his government on this process. However, even with these positive steps, India is only America's 11th largest trading partner and 18th largest export market. Our commercial relationship has simply not lived up to its enormous potential. We've known this for decades, but today, given the headwinds in the global economy, neither of us can afford this underperformance any longer. As President Obama has said, we simply must make it easier for Indian and American businesses to buy from each other, to invest in each other, and to create with each other. We must take action to address the impediments that our businesses and economies face. And we will not be successful without the engagement and input of our private sectors. Businesses appreciate the commercial opportunity presented by closer U.S.-India economic ties. And they understand the policies that inhibit the next investment or the next deal. Over the last year, we have taken two important steps to ensure that the economic issues and private sector input are at the heart of our bilateral relationship. First, our leaders elevated our commercial relationship by creating the Strategic and Commercial Dialogue, which will convene tomorrow for the first time. Second, we reinvigorated the U.S.-India CEO Forum, which met earlier today. For the commercial portion, our initial SNCD work plan focuses on our nation's joint priorities, including ease of doing business, infrastructure development, innovation and entrepreneurship, standards, and global supply chain. Our goals are very simple: to make it easier for foreign and domestic firms to do business in India and the United States, to deepen our ties of trade and commerce, and to strengthen our bilateral commercial bonds in ways that benefit the workers and the businesses in both our countries. The CEO Forum, which was led by Honeywell CEO David Cote and Tata Chairman Cyrus Mistry, is proving to be a strong contributor to the SNCD. The CEOs have already developed an aggressive work plan and a long list of recommendations on issues that are critically important to our bilateral commercial relationship, such as developing creative solutions to overcome India's infrastructure financing challenges, or enhancing cooperation in energy and renewables to meet India's growing power demands, and fostering closer ties between our healthcare industries to address the burden of non-communicable diseases and improve access to medical technology in India. Their input is essential guidance for our policymaking efforts. Beyond this inaugural SNCD, the private sectors from each country, including the CEO Forum and organizations like the USIBC, must be active participants in driving our dialogue forward and holding the two governments accountable to deliver results. Together, we have an extraordinary opportunity to help Prime Minister Modi achieve his vision of broadly shared prosperity for India's people. Together, we have an extraordinary opportunity to help President Obama advance his vision of greater economic security for all Americans. Together, we have an extraordinary opportunity to realize the potential and promise of the U.S.-India economic relationship. So I hope everyone here, Indian and American, in government and in the private sector, will join us in seizing this opportunity to keep our nations open for more business together. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Secretary. I think USIBC stands behind the objective of trying to drive this $500 billion trade between the two countries. And I can assure you that we work every day, inch by inch, $1 billion or $1 billion on an annual basis to push this objective. On that note, I would like to extend a warm welcome to Minister of Commerce from Government of India for her address. I like to say warm welcome because she's coming for the first time at USIBC event in Washington, D.C. And so, Madam Minister, welcome to D.C. and to your event itself.
Good evening. Let me start by wishing the U.S.-India Business Council several 40 more years for the precious work that they've done in building a very strong and sensitive relationship between India and the U.S. They've been 40 golden years, and I hope to have several more 40 years, particularly when the atmosphere is so charged because of the political will and the commitment shown by both the leaders, President Obama and Prime Minister Modi, who have both set a very ambitious target for all of us to reach, about which my senior colleague, Madam Swaraj, and also my colleague, Commerce Secretary, Penny Pritzker, has spoken, of course being led by that wonderful introductory comments given by Vice President Joe Biden. A recall, of course, the expansive note with which the positive energy with which this relationship has to be built up has been spoken by John Kerry himself. There's just a lot of things happening between India and the U.S. This is the best of time when strategic and commercial dialogues have been elevated in their stature, and there's a lot of traction which these two dialogues have obtained. Tomorrow will be the first time they will initiate the process. There's a lot of good work already which has started. In fact, India, since the last meeting of both the summit-level meeting which happened in India, has taken a lot of steps, and those steps have contributed towards building a lot of confidence between the Indian and the U.S. business houses. We've taken such steps which are now becoming fairly obvious and are in the public domain, whether it is towards easing the ease of doing business is being bettered, or whether you're looking at legislative and executive measures. There are several such steps taken by the current government, and in fact, ease of doing business is one of the classical examples I would take in talking up to the U.S. authorities, saying if we post the September visit of Mr. Kerry and Penny Pritzker, have taken specific initiatives to improve the condition with which investors and business houses would come to India, and as a result of which it was possible for the World Bank and KPMG to do the ranking of all the Indian states to bring in that kind of a spirit of competitive federalism, which is now obviously taken in a very good spirit. Indian states have been ranked. We are clearly moving towards a stage where we are opening up on becoming much more favored destination for all the foreign direct investments which we are seeking to have in India. On that note, I would certainly want also to underline that Indian investors have also been coming to the U.S., investing in a big deal, and in a very big way, creating jobs in the United States. So this relationship is to give strength and also to draw strength from each other's investments and also commitment to contributing towards one another's economy. In passing, in a lighter tone, and a lighter note, I was mentioning to the Commerce Secretary this afternoon, I would like to see the states of United States also ranked by the World Bank, just so the Indian investors can choose between them to see where they should be going in terms of investment and also better treatment of knowledge, workers who come not as migrants, but towards contributing towards a knowledge center, which is the U.S. being the center for innovation, are experts, whether they're scientists or technically qualified engineers or mathematicians, they come here to contribute towards your knowledge economy, and we derive a big strength from it. So there are issues between the two countries, just as we share a very big demographic dividend, which is waiting to serve US and also serve our country back. 65% of our population is under 35 years of age, and they're all, majority of them, going through their engineering and medical qualifications. So we understand there's a dearth of such services in the United States. So with this kind of a manpower, we are only moving around to create better facilities, better living conditions all over the world. There are ever so many opportunities within India. My senior colleague has clearly explained how railways or infrastructure development or building of smart cities all await technology and good investments. There are ever so much opportunity in India, and taking care of commerce and commercial interest, I will only open arm, welcome all of you all to come and take greater interest in India, invest and benefit for yourselves. I know the time between your dinner and also later in the evening is getting protracted by few of us trying to share our thoughts. I wouldn't extend the time any further, but I'm grateful to the US-India Business Council for having given me this opportunity to share a few of my thoughts with you. Thank you very much, and have a great day.